Well, welcome. Welcome to Sunrise Elementary School here in Anatolia, which is part of Rancho Cordova. Despite some popular sentiment to the contrary, we're absolutely within the city limits of Rancho Cordova. Welcome. Thank you very much for coming. This is the fourth candidate forum that's been put on by the Cordova City Council. It's the third of this set of races, the City Council and the Park District. My name is Craig Osborne. Some of you know me on the HOA Board of Directors here in Anatolia. I'm also on the board of the Cordova Community Council, and it's in that capacity that I'm hosting here this evening. The Cordova Community Council, we do a number of events, civic events around town, including these candidate forums. So we are excited to be hosting our fourth one for this election cycle. And this one, as I mentioned, is for the two races, City Council, Rancho Cordova, and the Cordova Recreation and Park District. A couple of things on logistics. The restrooms are right over here. They're through the same door. So there's one door there, and then behind that door, there's men's and women's. They have a really odd policy at this school. I have no idea why, but they chain the doors open to the restrooms. If you know why, come tell me afterwards. Every time we have an event here, the doors are chained open. But I understand you put in a request that they could possibly look at changing their policy for this evening. Anyway, I don't know how successful that's been. Other quick things, there are cards on the table in the back. If you have a question for the candidates in either race, please feel free to go pick up one of the cards, fill it in with your question, and bring it up to the moderator's table here. This evening's event is being co-hosted by both the Cordova Community Council and the Grapevine Independent. Shelley's the executive director of the Cordova Community Council, Shelley Blanchard. And Chris Minow here, who's the editor of the Grapevine Independent. So we're going to start with a quick introduction to each of the propositions that are on the ballot. And for that, we have our esteemed city finance director, Donna Silva, who's here to explain those to us, which I think is terrific. Again, this is simply explanatory. This is not advocating yes or no on these propositions, but explaining them as a service to us. And the rest of the evening will be spent with the city council candidates who are behind me now, and the park board candidates who will be starting here in a little bit. So with that, Donna, take it away.
Thank you, Craig. And thank you for that explanation of the purpose of my talk. I want to make sure you're all very clear that I'm not here to advocate a position on any ballot measure, simply to ask you to consider them, become educated about them. One of the primary reasons for incorporation was so that you would have the opportunity to make decisions about your city and where you live. Having local measures on the ballot is just your opportunity to do so. So I want to make sure you know about them and know where to get more information on them so you can go have your say. So there are three measures on the November ballot specific to Rancho Cordova. The first one is Measure E. It's concerning the utility user tax. The utility user tax was established by the county in the early 1990s. At 2.5%, it's one of the lowest utility user taxes in the state of California. About 150 cities across the state assess the utility user's tax. It's applied, in Rancho Cordova, it's applied to users of gas, electricity, water, cable, communications, and sewer. It was originally intended on the communications component to apply to all forms of communication. In the early 1990s, that was prior to the explosion of technology and technological advances. So because of the way the language is written, what's happened over time is that many of our new forms of communication, cell phones, voice over internet protocol, bundling of services, because of the language of our ordinance, are not subject to the utility user tax. So you have phone calls from landline phones that are paying the tax, phone calls from cell phones that are not. So Measure E would seek to modernize the language in protection of the communications component. Both of the ordinances across the state, when they were originally drafted, said that the utility user tax would be applied to communication, to long-distance phone calls, in the same manner as the federal excise tax. Several years ago, the IRS determined that the federal excise tax no longer applies to long-distance phone calls. So there is some litigation in some other cities concerning that issue, and if the cities do not prevail, then we could stand to have to follow suit and could stand to lose about $500,000 a year of important revenues from the communications tax. So Major E would change the language in the ordinance to remove the reference to the federal excise tax. The utility user tax is received into the general fund. It helps pay for public safety, code enforcement, graffiti, general government expenditures. If Major E passes, it could produce, depending upon the number of cell phone accounts in the city, anywhere from $500,000 to $1 million a year for those services. And if it doesn't pass, and if that legislation, if the litigation goes through, then we could stand to lose up to $500,000. The other two, how many people here have heard of Prop 19? But I thought many of you have. Rancho Cordova has two major ones on the ballot relative to marijuana, in an attempt to be, one of them at least, in an attempt to be proactive concerning Prop 19. The first major H, would, in the event that Prop 19 or any other future legislation making marijuana legal in California, would institute a tax on the commercial sale and transportation of marijuana. Prop 19 allows local governments to charge taxes on marijuana, and presumably any other future legislation would as well. So if Major H passes, the city would have the ability to assess a tax on the commercial sales of marijuana. But I want to make it very clear that the current city council does not endorse marijuana. They are not they do not endorse any marijuana activities in the city. We're just trying to be proactive in the event that we're forced to allow it. The other major relative to marijuana is Major O, and Major O is a tax on the cultivation of marijuana. We are having some complaints in the community of residences that are using their homes to grow marijuana for medicinal purposes. Growing in the backyard can cause odor problems, safety concerns. Growing inside can be a degradation of the housing stock because it requires large amounts of electricity, which can overload the electric panels and cause fires. It can also cause humidity problems leading to mold. We've actually found some homes in the city that have been completely converted into growing operations. So the city passed an ordinance that regulates how medical marijuana can be grown on a residential property, and Major O would seek to put in place a tax to help offset the cost. There is a flyer in the back of the room on all three. It was sent out to every home for your educational purposes. There's more information on all three ballot measures available on the website. Again, my name is Donna Silva. Any of you can call me at the city. I'm easy to get a hold of. My information is on the website. I'm happy to answer any of your questions either later, or I think I've got time to take a couple questions tonight if anybody has any. Yes, sir.
Regulation of how marijuana is grown, is that actually regulated? Growing practices. Like how is that regulated?
It limits the amount of space that can be used for the cultivation of marijuana. It requires inspections by the building department to make sure that it's up to code, so that there's not unsafe draws on electricity, and there's not
construction. Okay, diesel generator and stuff like that.
Any other questions? Okay, thank you for your time.
First of all, I want to let anybody who has any kind of rebuttal, if you want to raise your hand and speak, that's fine. But we also have a question that I thought you might want to appeal.
If that's okay with you. And the question is, since the UUT was defeated 2 years ago, was it a good decision for the city to put it back on the ballot? Why or why not?
last, which meant that the proceeds were dedicated to a specific purpose. And a special town requires two-thirds voter approval. It received 57% voter approval. Because of that majority approval that it got, the council chose to place it back on, or partially because of that, the council put it back on the major November as a general tax, which only requires a simple majority to be approved. So that was the reason why you've seen it before, and now you're seeing it again.
Thank you very much. Is there anybody who would like to say anything regarding these issues, these measures? All right, we will move on to the actual forum section of our forum. We're going to do this forum in the same way that we've conducted other forums in the past, and that is that each candidate will have a two-minute opening statement that they will make, followed by questions from you, the audience, and also questions that Shelley and I have prepared if necessary. We prefer to stick with audience questions if possible. And then we'll go in a round-robin fashion. We'll start with Linda with the first question after we do the opening remarks. You'll have 2 minutes to answer each question. And the second question, we'll start with Mike. We'll continue in that fashion. And each candidate will have an opportunity to answer each question. We'll go for 45 minutes. We will have a timer who will let you know when you are getting close to the end of your 2 minutes for each question and also the end of your two-minute opening statement. We, in between having our council candidate and our park board candidates, we'll have a short break where you can enjoy cupcakes and cookies and drinks. There are cards in the back if you'd like to write your questions down and bring them up to the table. And we will begin with opening statements now. Does anybody have any questions?
One question, maybe I misread it. I thought it was 3 minutes on the opening statement and 2 on the final.
That's what it said. Three opening, 2 for questions and 2 for
final. We'll go ahead, since that's the impression everyone's under, we'll go ahead and go with that. We'll do 3 minutes for the opening statements, 2 minutes when we do your closing statement, and 2 minutes for each question. So we'll begin opening statements now with Council Member Linda Bell.